Yes, welcome to Seriously Speaking. This week, we continue in our series of meet and greet those who want to be able to run for elective office. And it's my pleasure to have someone who, before people started talking about, oh, go and run for office, I had seen it. So I'll take a break. And I must remind you, though, that this series is really about getting to know the people, not necessarily the parties they're running under. For us, we must understand the individuals who seek or who took the position of, I want to put myself up for service. I'll be right back if you don't go away. Well, this young man, well, young to me, I've known for more than 15 years, so thereabout. He was much younger at that time. And it was somewhere in maybe 4 or 5 years ago, maybe more than 5 years ago, 7 years ago, when he started a project where he went around painting houses in Mushin. I always thought it was crazy anyway. And I was like, you are so fired up by the desire to change the young people. Maybe you should one day run for political office. And that was it. But then again, sometime in about a year and a half ago, let me introduce him. Let him tell you about it. My guest on the show today is Fela Durotoye. It's nice to have you on the show.
Well, look, everybody will call you Adesuwa because they're on show. I'm going to still call you Auntie Adesuwa. That's who we are. And that's how we roll.
I know.
All right? It's great to be on Seriously Speaking.
I'm glad because
I'm
happy
that I made it.
The last time you were too ill to come.
Yes. And that sometimes comes from just the level of exhaustion that sometimes the journey that we're on puts your body under.
Mm-hmm. But okay, I mean, besides that, I came to your house one morning, mm-hmm. and I heard when the not too young to run things were coming mm-hmm. around, mm-hmm. and I was hearing about young people running for office. And the day before, I'd seen your wife, Tara, who's my friend. She mentors me, just like I'm her mentee.
Yes.
And she's my mentee.
And just like you mentor her.
I know. So I heard Tara speak some, I'm like, I don't know why Tara can't run for office. And I went to her, I was telling my husband, I said, this girl, maybe she should run for, because she knows so many people. It's a function of knowing people. I've had people tell me things like that too.
Yes.
And I said, Tara has the heart. And my husband said, what about her husband? Mm. I came to her, and I said, are you not going to run for office? Everybody's running, you know. Go and run for office. And you thought I was crazy. But did you already know at that time?
Yes, I did.
Which
was why I was looking at you strange.
Yes.
Because apart from Tara and I, nobody else knew that we were going to do that. So when you came, I had just come back from a trip mm-hmm. where, in a sense, I had come to that conclusion that this was something that needed to be done. And for me, needed to be done is the following things. Number one, that we need to bust this myth that people who don't want to steal, that people who do not have political experience, that people who have a great vision for their nation, who have the right character, have the right values, have the competence, have the leadership experience, even if not political experience, mm-hmm. that people like that can never aspire for office because it is just not done. And that needed to be busted, mm-hmm. okay? So that we can have a critical mass of people that are gonna run. And the second thing was that, you know, when you look at the numbers, and this is 2015 elections, 96 million people above the age of 18, 68 million voters cards issued, 28 million votes counted, which you and I know included multiple voting, aka rigging. The third thing was very simple, that we needed to be able to get people, and I was giving you certain statistics, 96 million people above the age of 18 in 2015, 68 million votes that had been, voters' cards issued, 28 million votes counted. Even if every vote was a bona fide voter, which we know it was not. 40 million people who got voters' cards
didn't go and vote.
And another 30 million did not even bother to get their voters' cards. So when you look at it, democracy is supposed to be a simple rule. The majority takes the decision for everybody. That's what it's supposed to be. But now we are seeing 28 million people taking the decision on behalf of and 70 million people who never took their
chance. It's a function of how disillusioned that they are.
Yes, so no, there are different reasons why most people didn't get involved or, you know, didn't step up to the plate. But one of the most important was that people were saying, when I look at the options available, I'm not inspired by any of the options.
What's the point?
So the point is, how do we get people who can inspire the voters to go out and vote, and how do we get the voters to encourage those who can inspire them?
Tell me, your mom, I mean, you grew up in a university environment, yes. University of Ife.
Yes.
Was there any time mommy ever told you? I'm saying mommy because she's the one that's lived longest, you know. Yes. Ever saw something like that in you?
Well, I'll tell you the story that she told me when I was much older, but she told me, a very interesting story. My father died when I was only 9 years old. So, mm-hmm. I mean, I had a great relationship with my dad, but I didn't hear this story until maybe almost 26 years old or so, when my mother told me that when she was 7 months pregnant, they were in Canada. Mm-hmm. They were lecturers in University of Toronto, and my father had a dream. And in that dream, my father said, had woken her up and said, the one you are carrying is a special one. We have to take him home. And don't, look, it, you know, Auntie, you and I know, Tara and I have three boys, right? Mm-hmm. And one time we were talking about, should we try for a girl? Mm-hmm. I told her, look, from based on the results we have, clearly I don't have any girls inside me. But my father had had a boy and a girl. So there was no way they were supposed to be able to know if this third one was going to be a boy or a girl. And I don't know what he saw, but clearly.
So you're not the first son, you're not the only child.
I'm not the only child, but bottom line was, at 7 months, my mom began to make her way home. And so whilst I was conceived in Toronto, Canada, I was received in Oyewole, Ibadan. And it's a very funny story because, I mean, bottom line is that I used to wonder for a long time what my father saw. And I realized that one thing is for sure, if I had been born in Canada, maybe I wouldn't have never lived in Nigeria. Maybe I would never have connected. My heart would never have connected to Nigeria. And even if I
had dual citizenship. Because you'd have had that passport to run away.
If I had dual citizenship, then I probably would not have been able to run for office. So the point that I'm making is that there must have been something. So I was told that I was special at that time.
So, you know, fine, most of your work, I mean, anybody can Google you and find all those details. Mm-hmm. I'm getting to the nitty gritty. Most of your work has been around the youth. And even before anybody said, you've always won this little thing you have there, that's why I thought about this Nigerian thing.
This Nigerian pin. I've been wearing this pin since 2006.
A long time.
There was only one day that I went out without wearing it. And I called home and I told my wife, I said, I forgot my Nigerian pin and I feel like I'm naked.
So why was that? Was it because you knew you would run for office someday?
No. Because used to say to me things like, "Do you work for government?" And I say,
"Yes,
no."
True.
They said, "Why are you wearing a Nigerian pin?" I thought you said it was Nigerian pin, not a government identity. Mm-hmm. So shouldn't every Nigerian love Nigeria? Shouldn't we all wear our identity? Shouldn't we all be proud of our country? At least be proud of trying to make a nation that we are proud of. And I think that's basically what this is about.
So this, I mean, for me though, this passion that you have, I never knew what ignited it. I want to know what ignited it. Because you must have been a little boy. Maybe it's this prophecy your father had.
To be honest with you, I don't know what usually ignites passion. Sometimes passion is ignited by pain. But I think that generally, I believe that passion is a gift, is a natural gift that we all receive. And I think it's divinely given. So people can't tell why they like what they like or how come they like it. But I'll tell you some interesting things. Number one, one of my best friends, childhood best friends when I was growing up, is a gentleman by the name of Biodun Adegbomere. And he said to me finally when I talked to him about the fact that I was going to run, and he said to me, "But have you forgotten that I've been calling you Duro for president since you were 12 years old?" And then I said, "Wow." And I asked him, I said, "What did you see?" And again, it was one of those things that everybody keeps saying, you've always had a passion for Nigeria. If anybody wanted to get under your skin, let them say something negative about Nigeria.
Anywhere in the world.
You will literally. And you know, so I can't tell you where it is, but it's something that is a natural gift. It's a natural passion. And I believe in Nigeria.
I'll take a break because I must get some of these young people to engage you because to some of us, it still is a pipe dream. Mm-hmm. I'll be right back. I return to the studio now, but with two vibrant people, one person under 30, the other person around Fela's age of 40-something. But I mean, I must point out here that before we came back on set, my stylist, Favo, said she's getting the Obama vibe with your story. You know that my family, my wife, and people thought I would never happen. You get what I mean? I don't know, but maybe she's predicting something.
I hope.
It's hope for you.
Oh, yes. Hope is what we need in Nigeria, isn't it?
Yeah.
It is one of the most important things. I think that hope and faith are things we need in Nigeria. Not faith from the religious point of view, but just faith in a belief that we can do something. Because, you know, this generation has a major responsibility. And the responsibility we have is to build a nation that we want to live in and pass to our children.
It's time to say, I think Okon should start. Okon is this youth he's talking about, Abi. Okon just shy of 28.
Yes.
A young man, but he's not the typical young man because Okon works and he started his business even before 28.
And his business is doing very well.
How do you know that?
He told me before we started.
Oh, you've already engaged. So what do you think about his dream?
I think...
I'm calling it dream. It's still a dream, isn't it?
Yeah, it's still a dream until it becomes a reality.
Okay.
It's still a dream. I think it's interesting because it's not every day you see a young individual and someone who doesn't have so much of a political background decide to run for the highest office in Nigeria. So it's pretty interesting for some of us seeing Ms. Fela wanting to run for president.
So what concerns you, though? Do you have any concerns about it? Well, because that's why you're here, to ask him questions and to put him on the spot.
Well, what concerns me is the fact that if you look at Nigeria's history, we've never really had someone who doesn't have a military or political background become president. So what makes him feel that without this, he has enough, he's gathered enough experience, his little political career, okay, to run for the highest office?
Okay, do I answer that?
Okay, then I wanted to wait. I want to introduce Wale first. Wale, I mean, he stopped commenting on Facebook, but I know somebody who's also passionately in love with Nigeria, and it's not too late to run too, you know. They've signed a not too young,
never too late,
not too young to run bill. And Wale, I mean, Wale just turned, you're turned to 45. So, but you have children who are going to inherit this country, and it bothers you, right? So Wale is a film producer and a political commentator. So I think you should answer that question first before Wale asks.
Okay, so Okon. And I'm sure this is in the heart of Wale, as with probably most of the people who are watching us today. How can someone without political experience be able to do well as a national leader or president? Well, I think that, again, think about it. You ask yourself, is it political experience or leadership experience that the president of Nigeria requires? That's the first thing we've got to ask ourselves. That, you know, what exactly do we need? What does a good leader, a good person, especially where Nigeria is today, what kind of person do we need? First of all, let's look at the key challenges as it relates to Nigeria. Today, you look at a nation that is really very fractured around, you know, political, social, tribal, religious, all the lines. We're fractured as a nation. What do you need? You need somebody who can kind of like gather the people together and bring them together. Do you agree? Another thing is, you need someone who can paint a vision that most Nigerians from different parts of Nigeria, all different ages, generations, will like to be a part of. Is that right? But we also need the economy to be fixed. And we know that the most important engine of the economy is businesses, especially small and medium scale businesses. So it'd be nice for you to have a president that has an understanding of what it takes to start businesses, grow businesses, and help businesses.
Okay, right? Because you've done that with a lot of young people. Okay. However, I mean, I think what his concerns are a little different.
Yeah, well, I actually subscribe to his, you know, to his own fears, but my own fear is this, as in, because I do Facebook a lot. I think it's a more intellectual medium. I think Facebook, Instagram is just for people who just want to
share something.
Now, so I'm able to feel the Nigerian pulse on Facebook. I hear people comment. If you can come on Facebook, open an account, make comments, then you have some level of education. And I must tell you, if there's anything this president has thrown up, is the fact that we are very fragmented now. But more than that, I read people's comments. And I think, I'm short of words to use, maybe it's to use the word dumb. The dumbness you see from people's comments, and I'm thinking now, I've always had this theory, whoever knows me knows that. My theory has always been, it would be unrighteous. If you think it's God who appoints leaders, then it would be unrighteous for God to pick a leader out of the minority. So you can't have 50 wolves and then maybe 5 sheep, and then you want to elect a president, you make the sheep the president. Now, we know your story, we know your pedigree, we know everything about you. It's clear you have some leadership
abilities. So is sheep or wolf?
It's sheep. It's 5. Now, the bunch of Nigerians, and now, so if you're going to have a leader, and every time I look at our president, it just becomes clear to me that, you know, not the president, every president we've ever had, they're just a reflection of the majority of the people.
So you're thinking someone like him?
Number, until we have a critical number, I don't think it would be fair for God to make a president in Nigeria intelligent. If you read the comments on Facebook.
So they bite him off.
No. I think that you're very right. The challenge is, where is the critical number? Just before we came on this panel, I was sharing with Auntie Adesuwa about how in 2015, 70 million people did not vote. Not that they were not, the money was there to induce them. They were not those kind of people that wanted to be induced to vote. The question you ask is, what were those people, why did they not vote? Was it because they didn't find the kind of persons that they wanted amongst the aspirants? Possibly. Could it be that they just didn't like the political system the way it is? Possibly.
That's not fair.
But
that's not right.
No, I'm just saying, whatever the reason is, 70 million people did not go out to vote for whatever the reason is. The question is, if you find out what that reason is, you might just find out that it was that they were looking for someone different. And that's why everyone who wants a greater Nigeria has to go and get their PVC. Your PVC is not just your power to vote. I mean, your PVC is not just your permanent voter's card. It is the power to vote your choice.
Okay.
And we have to choose between the past and the future.
Fortunately, can we just hold hands? We agree to vote as we like.
Let me
I have to go.
Our generation will win, but I know one of our generation who is also running, and I wish he never wins. Because he has not emotional...
Let our generation decide.
Let our generation decide.
Let your generation decide.
Best
His auntie is Indian. He's not our
generation. Of your place.
I've given you the time. I've given you
our generation.
I've given you the time. We've met you. I know you. I could see you in Aso Rock and be comfortable. But are you going to get there? I don't know. And we can only hope that the young people who are watching, just for me, go and get involved. Either you run or you vote. Whatever it is, do something. We'll see you again. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you.
And thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.